feels like home, because when we came, we had practically nothing, and some seeds were planted, and then I see the progress. I see a nice temple here, I see it, a manor that George Harrison gave us outside of town. I see little children that weren't children now growing up. I see bright-faced devotees. I see seeds that we planted being manifest, singing in the streets. At first, we didn't do that. So I'm very happy, and I always liked it here. When I first arrived in Britain, I had a piece of paper and it dropped. And the man next to me said, "Sorry." And I'm thinking, this is really an empathetic group of people, that he's sorry that I dropped the paper, and he picked it up. And then I asked him for directions and he took me. So this was a sign of, not everybody, but in general, some civilized people. I've always liked it here. So, coming back again, it's very enlivening, especially on Radharani's appearance day. She's the soul of compassion. She's Krishna's partner. You see Radha-Krishna. But compassion is very important, and she's the one who's compassionate. Even my guru, I'll tell that story, he was teasing me. But he said, if I don't forgive you, Krishna will. But if Krishna doesn't, Radharani certainly will. Mm-hmm. So she's the soul of compassion. And in Britain, one day I was feeling sad about the plight of people in the world. And I said, I said to my guru, sometimes I wonder why people are so unjust to each other. And sometimes I wonder why there's so much war. And sometimes, and he interrupted and he said, why sometimes? Which was the message, you should always be compassionate. Even if you're jolly, even if you're doing something, you should have an empathy with the plight of people in the world. And when we become filled with Krishna, we want to give it. At first there's a regulatory stage, a beginning stage. It's called Vaidya Bhakti, where we learn the rules and regulations, the foundation, we're building it. But when my guru, Swami A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada, told me there's a foundation stage, but then there's another stage where it becomes spontaneous. The rules and regulations, everything becomes part of you, then you don't have to think about it. You don't have to think about how your nails grow. You don't have to think about it. When he said the spontaneous stage, suddenly a lightness came. And I saw that, yes, Krishna consciousness is a great adventure. And when you unblock, you let Krishna come inside, magic happens every day. Magic, magic. And so it was very nice, but he instilled on me to have compassion as much as possible. When he said the spontaneous stage, but the magic happened pretty early because he was magic. And because there was no body as examples, there was no movement when I started. I was the seventh devotee in the West. There were no books, well, three books, but no drums, no kartals, and no elders except the Swamiji. But the Swamiji was enough. In San Francisco, we were studying Zen Buddhism, Japan, African, Native American sensibilities, spiritualities, but we wanted a Swami, and he came and he was the Swami. He was delightful. He was charming, he was fun, but he also told that these boys and girls have been able to leave their hedonistic, pleasurable ways because I brought them the Vedic system. But we didn't know he was doing that. He did it, and he instilled in us. So when we were walking early in the morning, there were some ducks. And some devotee said, "Get out of the way, the Swami's walking." And I thought, these ducks, it's their habitat. They were here before us. It's a little audacious. And the ducks were waking up and quack, quack. And the Swami looks over and says, "As you were thinking the ducks are disturbing us, they are thinking we are disturbing them." So at that point, I saw this compassion. I saw that he was able to look into every living entity's heart. Later, he said, "We don't even kill an ant. That is love." So I saw these things, and I marveled at them, and there was lessons, different lessons, and that's how the spontaneous stage manifested.